book on this topic. Okay, now let's change topic, and this is the end of Act One in this forum, and we are going to talk about the importance of oceans for the survival of human beings. So Jacques Attali, who wrote a book called It's a Story of the Sea, which is going to be published in a few days' time, along with him, Boyan Snat, who invented a machine to clean up the oceans. But first, let's watch a video.
Plastic pollution problem has always been portrayed as something that is unsolvable. The story has always been, okay, we can't clean it up, so the best thing we can do is not make it worse. To me, that's a very uninspiring message.
Devised the first real plan to try to clean things up.
What we're doing here now, it has never been done before.
He wants to build the largest floating barrier ever deployed.
What I really hope is that the ocean cleanup in this century can be a symbol for us using technology to actually make things better.
Et le jeune homme, donc on peut les applaudir, bravo.
I think he deserves a round of applause. So the young man who wants to clean the ocean is here in France for the first time for a discussion with Jacques Attali. Jacques Attali, your book, C'est une histoire de la mer, is being released next week by Fayard.
Thank you. The question of ocean is not only a matter of aesthetics to see a cleanup of something which is full of garbage, but it's absolutely vital for mankind, because if we don't do that, ocean will die, and if ocean die, we die too, for many reasons. And it's all not only because we should take what is at the surface, but we need to take what is down, because 85% of the whole waste are down, not at the surface. You decided at a very old age to tackle this huge problem that no one is really tackling. Why did you embark into that?
Sure, yeah. So when I was 16 years old, I was scuba diving in Greece just on a family holiday. And at some point in time, I looked around me and I realized, hey, I see more plastic bags than fish. And I was quite disappointed by that because I was expecting to see all these beautiful things. And I thought, why don't we clean this up? And that simple question sort of kept coming back to me in my head day after day after day, and then I thought, well, maybe I should think about how we could do this. And actually, back then I was still in high school, so we had to do a science project, and I decided to pick this as a topic to really understand the problem and why everyone told me it would be impossible to clean up. So I read all the papers, and then after a year of trying different ideas in my head, eventually we came up with this simple idea of, instead of going after the plastic, which would take about 79,000 years with boats and nets, instead of doing that, we proposed to actually let the plastic come to us, saving time, energy, and cost. And now we've calculated that with a fleet of such systems deployed for 5 years, we can clean up half this this great Pacific garbage patch.
Yeah, because there are... But the reason I wanted you to come here today is to give first a lesson of what should be done on this absolutely vital issue, but also to demonstrate that only crazy ideas are good for huge problems, and we should dare whatever has not been dared before. Plus, could you come back to the question of why this is mainly the Pacific Ocean, and why this is mainly China, which is responsible for all that?
Sure. So there are five areas in the world where ocean plastic concentrates. These are called the subtropical gyres, and these are areas where the currents converge, a bit like the hole in your bathtub. And what happens is that the plastic concentrates there and doesn't go away by itself. So it accumulates, and we even see plastic going back to the 1960s, 1970s in those garbage patches. So once it's in there, it's there to stay unless we clean up. And the largest one of which is the one between Hawaii and California, primarily because Asia is on one side of that. And what we see now in Asia is that you have a large discrepancy between what's between the consumption of plastic and the waste infrastructure. So yeah, really, probably over two-thirds of the plastic entering the ocean actually comes from Asia today.
Yes, from the rivers of China going to the sea, and then
yes,
and then. But you, what is your agenda? Because you deal with one specific place in the Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
Which is absolutely huge, but still a tiny portion of what should be done.
Yeah, so the area we're starting on is this Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It's about six times the size of France, so it's quite a big area, and that's exactly the challenge. Although there is a lot of plastic, it's spread out over a vast area. So if you think about the density, it's actually not that high. It's not like an island where you can walk on, what some people think. So the key is that we first concentrate the plastic before we take it out. So the next step is to actually, so over the past 2 years, we've done the reconnaissance. So we know where the plastic is, we know how much plastic is out there. We've done the testing, so we've done scale model testing, many prototypes we've deployed on the North Sea, including one just 2 days ago. And now we are really making the final preparations to deploy the first full-scale system, which is going to be launched from San Francisco in May next year. And if we have one, of course, then we, even if the first one works, then we want to expand to 60 of these cleanup systems. And once we have the 60, we want to expand to all these five areas in the world. So, but you have to sort of start somewhere, I think.
Of course. But correct me if I'm wrong, this is going to take care, in the best case scenario, only of a waste which is on the surface.
Right.
A small
right.
part of the whole
yeah.
which is down.
It's actually a lot more than people think. So we've done measurements to see what's the vertical distribution of plastic. And what we see is that virtually all of the buoyant plastic, so the types of plastics that naturally float, they can be found in the top 4 meters of the water. So that's how deep our barriers go. Of course, there are types of plastic that naturally sink, things like PET, like what the bottle is made out of. If the cap is not on there, it would actually sink. But that all happens sort of close to shore. But the stuff that keeps in the ocean, that keeps floating at the ocean for decades, that's really the floating fraction. And that's exactly the problem, because most life is also at the surface.
Can you explain also why we find it in the fishes and that we eat back plastic when we eat fish?
Yeah, the longer you wait, the longer plastic is in the ocean, the more it degrades. And it doesn't biodegrade, but it photodegrades. So because of the sunlight, it breaks down into smaller and smaller pieces. And those small pieces get sort of the size of plankton. Fish then consume those pieces. And actually, chemicals like PCBs, like DDT, like these very dangerous chemicals, they are attaching to the plastic. And through the plastic, those chemicals end up in the food chain, which is a health problem.
Would you agree with the statistics saying that one fish out of three that we eat is full of plastic?
I've read a similar figure, yeah.
But we don't know what is the danger of eating that for the moment.
Right.
What is your aim in 20 years?
Yeah, so So next year, first cleanup system.
20 years.
Yes. Then those cleanup systems will be there for 20 years. So probably in 20 years, so that's almost 2040. But then we should probably have a reduction of concentration of about 90% in the ocean. And we do that by deploying the systems in the oceans. And eventually, we also want to develop spin-off systems to deploy near to shore or near river mouths to also intercept plastic before it reaches the oceans. So really tackling two sides of the equation, I think we can have almost no more plastic in the ocean.
And as a last question, how much all that will cost, knowing that the recycling will not suffice to finance the whole process?
Sure.
Even if it works, but
yeah. So we are structured as a non-profit foundation because we realize, well, it's not going to be a big profit maker for sure. So far, we raised about $35 million coming from private philanthropy. So just people who think, well, this is a great adventure. I want to be part of this. Starting next year, we will start to deploy a fleet of systems, and then you can have, say, one company per cleanup system. You can own your own cleanup.
The global cost will be what?
So each system can be sponsored for about 5 million euros. So then those are out there. And then the operational cost, we are confident that part we can cover with recycling of the ocean plastic.
Thank you very much.
Right, thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Merci, Bojan Slat.
Well, thank you very much, Bojan Slat. Thank you, Jacques Attali, for this conversation, which closes Act 1 on the challenges of this...